Hi, my dear friend called me in a panic that his daughter is staring into space, her eyes were rolling up, and she keeps doing that multiple times during the day and at home at school. So he was so worried, and I asked him a few questions. I was able to pinpoint the diagnosis over the phone. Let's talk today in depth about staring spells and absence epilepsy, and we'll give you all the new updates about the diagnosis and the new treatments of this condition today in this video. I'm Dr. Omar Danoun, an epilepsy specialist neurologist, and welcome to the Epilepsy Encyclopedia, where you find all the information you need to take good care of yourself and your loved one with epilepsy. Staring spells can be from multiple different causes, and they can be different from one person to another depending on their age and the other features of those staring spells. Number one is the most common is childhood absence epilepsy, and this is called absence, not absent epilepsy, you know. This is a French word. Everything looks cooler in French. So it's called absence epilepsy. And this is the most common type of staring spells and absence seizures. And it happens in school age kids. And the most common age is 6 years old. And it can be plus and minus a few years up until 10 years of age. The kids will start having staring spells and stare into space. Their eyes will start rolling up, and they happen multiple times during the day. And the school teacher will thought that, oh, the kid is daydreaming or they're not paying attention in class. And they might have issues with school because they're like keep having those staring spells, so they're not able to focus during the class. How do you make the diagnosis of absence seizures? The diagnosis of absence epilepsy or absence seizures can be actually done in the doctor's office, or you can do it now at home. So the way to do this is that we can trigger seizures by having the child hyperventilate, which means like breathe fast. The way we do this is that we can do a pinhole, like we'll ask the child to keep like blowing that pinhole, and this hyperventilation will cause the child to have like be in pinhole, and then we'll stop. Like this child, see, he's blowing, all of a sudden there is an absence seizure. So this is a diagnosis can be done at home, or we can ask him to blow on a tissue of paper, and that can induce the absence seizure. It happens about 80 to 90% of the seizures. The children often have normal development and they do well and, at school. And sometimes it can affect their school performance because of this chunky lecture that they are doing, and they're just like sitting at home and lecture is like 5 plus 17 and it's like the whole time is just like a broken record, and they cannot focus very well, and they can be affected. So that's why it is important to treat them, to help them grow very well. And if the child has other types of seizures, like generalized tonic-clonic seizures, grand mal shaking seizures, then it might be a different diagnosis than absence epilepsy. If you have any questions, you can leave them in the comments below, and especially in the last video that I published on this channel. So make sure you subscribe and hit the notification bell, because I do go live stream multiple times, and every time I go live you can ask all your questions and get them live answered by me. And if you want to get a direct consultation with me, I treat patients and can give you a remote second opinion for patients 16 years and older, like adult patients, and you can do this, and I will give you all the information in the description of this video. The other test we can do is doing an EEG. So EEG is a brainwave test that we put wires on the head, and we measure the electricity of the brain. And with this test, we can measure the electricity, and often we can capture seizures or abnormal electrical discharges in the brain. It happens in the majority of the cases. It is better to have the child sleep during the EEG, because sometimes when they sleep, the discharges will be more obvious, and to do hyperventilation, pinhole, and to do the photic stimulation, all of those techniques help increase the yield of the EEG. And if a seizure happens, we can see it in the brain waves, and we ask the child questions to interact and see if they are aware or not, and make the diagnosis right there. Brain MRI is not necessary in typical childhood absence epilepsy. If they have normal exam and the EEG is typical, you don't need a brain MRI, and most of the time it will come back normal. It should be normal in this situation. There are other comorbidities that happen with childhood absence epilepsy, and most of them are developmental issues. Sometimes they will have ADHD, sometimes they will have some attention deficits and inability to concentrate, and or affecting their school performance. They can be normal development, but they might be having those issues as well. They have higher risk of contracting depression, anxiety, and having learning disability with time. What causes childhood absence epilepsy? The cause of childhood absence epilepsy is polygenic, which means that there are multiple genes and multiple mutations or changes in the genes that lead to changes in the electrical electricity flow in the brain, and the control of electricity leading to excitability in the whole system and leading to epilepsy. So there are multiple channels and receptors that control the electricity in the brain. Those are made of proteins. The proteins are made of genes, and those genes can have mutations or changes. So that will lead to kind of irritability in the brain because of that. There are about 20% of children will have history of febrile seizures before, and about half will have a positive family history of seizures and epilepsy in a first degree relative or second degree one. So genetic testing are now available. We can do epilepsy panels and generalized epilepsy panels and genetic testing, but unfortunately for childhood absence epilepsy, the yield is pretty low because it's a polygenic and there are multiple genes that can affect to be causing this diagnosis. How do we treat childhood absence epilepsy? The treatment of absence epilepsy is very much focused on improving quality of life, social interaction, and school performance. So it is very important to give the right medications for this condition. Not all medications will work, so there are specific medication for this condition, and the most important one and the first choice is ethosoxamide or Zorantin. So this medicine is ethosoxamide, specifically working on the thalamus to the cortex connection where the seizure happened, and it works on those calcium channels, and it can help with the seizures, and multiple studies show that this is the best medication to control the seizures. The way we dose ethosoxamide is we start between 5 to 10 milligram per kilogram in 2 divided doses, and then we can increase over time to higher doses. In children who are more than 6 years of age, we give them 250 milligrams twice a day, and we can go up higher in the dose as the treatment response is and the tolerability and the side effect of the medicine. We generally aim for a dose of between 15 and 40 milligrams per kilogram divided into doses during the day. We do check the blood levels of ethosuximide to make sure that it is appropriate in the blood, and we aim for levels between 40 and 100 microgram per mil. We can do an EEG as we are titrating the medicine to see the electrical response to the treatment. And this medicine does have multiple side effects, and most of them are stomach side effects. GI side effects will be stomach upset, nausea, vomiting. It's kind of a little bit hard on the stomach, so we advise it to be given with food, so that it will make it easier on the children and the patients so that they can tolerate it better. It can also cause sleep disturbance and hyperactivity in some children. Ethosuximide treats only absence seizures. It does not treat generalized tonic-clonic seizures. So if there is also generalized tonic-clonic seizures, we have to give other medications to supplement that. The second medication can be given is valproic acid, which has been shown to be number 2 good medicine for the treatment of absence epilepsy. And we have made a whole video about valproic acid, there are lots of details about this. I would recommend you go to that video and review it so that you know all the details about this medicine. And the third line of treatment and the third medicine is Lamotrigine or Lamictal, which is also a medication by its on its own. It can help with those absence seizures. And we have made a whole video about Lamotrigine and Lamictal. You can watch it for all the details about this medicine and the right dosing and everything. It is important that those are the good medications for absence epilepsy. However, there are medications that are bad for absence epilepsy, and they can worsen the diagnosis and they can worsen the seizures, and most of them are the medications that are sodium channel blockers such as phenytoin, carbamazepine, oxcarbazepine. They can worsen the diagnosis of generalized epilepsy and absence epilepsy, and other medications such as vigabatrin, gabapentin, they can worsen the conditions. It's very important to be treated by a pediatric neurologist who knows those details about the treatment. There are some rare cases of resistant to medications and to treatment, and those cases can be treated by other treatment modalities such as the ketogenic diet and even vagus nerve stimulation. And we have made videos about vagus nerve stimulation and a whole video about ketogenic diet. You can review them. What is the prognosis and the outlook for children with childhood absence epilepsy? Well, the good thing is that the prognosis is usually favorable and good. Most of the cases, they will respond well to treatment and they outgrow their epilepsy. As the brain matures, the defected channels will not be working as the brain will go into the mature state. So it's usually self-limiting with time, but we do treat so that we can reserve the development and everything else. There are rare cases of about 10%. They continue to have seizures and they can go to other epilepsy syndrome like juvenile myoclonic epilepsy and what we call juvenile absence epilepsy with started to have generalized tonic-clonic seizures, and they might need long-term treatment as well. So there are Other causes of steering spills that are syndromes in children and pediatric population, such as we said, juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, they can have steering spills and myoclonic jerks, and they will have also generalized tonic-clonic seizures. Also can be juvenile absence epilepsy can be also a cause. And in some cases, there are the steering spills might not be even generalized epilepsy. It can be what we call focal epilepsy, and they call focal unaware seizures. The seizures mostly happen from the left side of the brain, where the communication happens in the left temporal lobe, and the seizure will impair the awareness and consciousness and will be staring and unresponsive. However, with this one, there will be a cascade of events that are different than staring spells. The patient will pause. They might have oral automatism, movements in their mouth. They might pick on their clothes, and then they might turn their head one side or another. They will shake all over. So not all staring spells are generalized epilepsy. Some of them are even focal epilepsy, but what differentiates is the sequence of events. It's very, very recommended to get a video of your loved one when they're having seizures so that you can take it to your neurologist and discuss it with them. So the generalized epilepsy is completely different in treatment and diagnosis from focal epilepsy. And to learn all about other generalized epilepsy syndromes and how they are correctly treated and not mistreated, you can see this video about all the different types of generalized epilepsy. And stay healthy and see you in the next one. Salam.